You said it's God's creation, so he do what he will?
Yes, there's more to that, but yes.
Okay, so if he do what he will, just like a question, I might be being stupid here, but if he created free will,
yes.
So why would it be his will to give us the free will to do anything that we want?
That's a fantastic question. Very honest question. Let me answer you freely. Let me just talk to this guy because he's waited patiently, apparently. Yeah, yeah. Have you waited to talk?
Right,
go on then. How are we doing?
His name is June, by the way.
It's June.
Hi, doing June. How are we doing? Yes. Yes.
I've seen so much good stuff.
And what do you think?
Very good.
Oh, thanks, be to God.
I love how you argue with politics.
Right?
Yes.
Yeah.
I wish I could be at that level one day.
Well, I mean, I think if you allow yourself to be filled with the knowledge of the prophets and the apostles, you could be. Question is, will you?
Maybe one day.
Maybe one day. So tell us, what is it you wanted to talk about? Was there any particular thing, or did you just want to have a general conversation? Oh, JC, right.
Yeah. Okay, so you're a Satanist, basically.
Yes.
So what kind of Satanist are we? Because there are metaphysical Satanists and then there are atheistic Satanists.
Theistic.
So you actually believe in a God?
Yes.
Do you believe that the devil is that God? The Satan is that God? No. So what God do you believe in?
Baphomet.
And...
Baphomet.
Baphomet.
Not
Baphomet. Not Baphomet. 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 Tell me a little bit about Baphomet.
What's the word? Where you're man or woman. Okay, hermaphrodite. Okay.
He's a hermaphrodite. What else?
Okay, so he's powerful.
Yep.
He is a creator in himself, but
yep.
He's not the creator of Earth.
Okay.
We do derive most of our morals from the Bible.
Right.
We do the timeline of the Bible with, you know, Jesus Christ, Noah's Ark, etc.
Yeah.
But we also have another doctrine called Dante's Inferno.
Right.
Where it describes the 9 levels of hell.
Right. Yep.
And that's pretty much it.
Okay. So I wanna put it to you. Sorry, June.
Like the month, June.
Okay. I want to put it to you, June, that the kind of religion that you've embraced is a very modern invention, and it's a very modern invention that emerges out of a milieu that we would call the New Age movement, and it's a spirituality of the self, and that cultural move to the self. And the idea of the self and the idea of self-identification and self-proclamation is something that emerges out of the trauma of World War I and World War II. Okay? The very fact that you are syncretizing Dante's Inferno, who was a devout Christian, and his meditation on hell is a work that, well, thankfully, I guess you probably read. It's a beautiful meditation on hell. And I would encourage everyone else to read Dante's Inferno. And then you're syncretizing that with the Bible and then this belief in another being.
Yes.
That you acknowledge is himself not all powerful.
Yep.
Now, would you agree with me that, do you believe there's more than one God?
Yes.
Right. And do you believe that there is a more powerful God than Baphomet?
Yes.
Do you believe that God is worthy of your worship?
No.
Why not?
Mainly due to how he describes morality here on Earth, whereas...
You want to hold it? We'll just pass it backwards and forwards.
Yeah, just pick. So
you hold it, and then when I talk, I'll hold it backwards and forwards. JC wants me to be his microphone man, and I just refuse.
Whereas mainly due to... there's a bunch of stuff that you can't do on Earth.
Yeah.
Whereas in, you know, you can't have sex before marriage, or you can't be gay or trans, etc.
Yeah.
Whereas in my own personal beliefs, I do think that's completely okay.
Yeah.
But again, I've heard arguments on why it isn't.
Yeah.
So I've heard it all before. Yeah. And again, I just don't believe in that moral outlook on God, which is why I don't worship him as a deity.
Okay. Do you accept that deity exists? That there is a God called Yahweh and he does prescribe these things? So you accept that God exists, but you refuse to worship him because you disagree with his morality. Is that right? I'm not strawmanning
you. No, you're not.
I'm being fair to you.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay. So here's the issue with this, right? June is... I'm really rubbish with names, by the way. So even... Here's the problem with it. Would you agree that this Yahweh, who prescribes this kind of reality, is also the creator?
Yeah.
Right.
100%.
Brilliant. If he creates it and owns it, does he get to decide what he does with it?
Yeah.
Right. So if he creates it, owns it, and decides what he does with it, it's therefore for him to say what is right and what is wrong. Yeah. Now, I think you've kind of strawmanned Christianity a bit.
Okay.
Because Christians look at questions of homosexuality and questions of transgender identity or gender dysphoria.
Yeah.
We see them as... we see them in a sense as emotional imbalances, mental imbalances, psychological imbalances. Yeah. We didn't always see it like that.
Yeah.
Some in the past, when we didn't understand how the human mind works and how sexuality works and things like that, we saw it as deviancy. We saw it as willful action. And there are still some Christians, sadly, who have that kind of 1940s understanding of these things.
Yeah.
But Christians who study the sciences accept that. You being gay is not a choice. I'm not saying you are, I'm just talking generally. Or you having gender dysphoria is not a choice.
Yeah.
It's a condition.
Yeah.
Now, the difference is, and this is, I mean, I don't know about if you identify as any one of those things. Do you?
I'm non-binary.
Non-binary, okay. So we would say, and I would say to you, that your identity is not found in your sexuality, in your gender.
Oh, yeah, 100%.
And it's not found in who you're attracted to.
Yeah, 100%.
Right. But this idea of, you are declaring yourself as non-binary, that is a political ideology that has emerged very recently.
Yeah.
And these are just the opinions of men, and we reject them.
Yeah.
Well, I would say to you, what I would call you to is to find your identity in Christ.
Mm.
And to find your identity in Christ, who himself was a virgin, who never had sex and never got married, but was the complete and perfect human being, means that we don't need sex to be complete. Yeah? Would you agree we don't need sex to be complete?
Yeah, 100%.
So you can be complete without sex.
Yeah.
So if God says that you can be complete without sex, and you agree that you can be complete without sex, and then he says to you, don't participate in homosexual sex, yeah? Then I would say to you that he's saying that for your benefit.
How so?
Right, great question. Mm-hmm. Have you ever been to a gum clinic?
A gum clinic?
Yeah.
No.
It's genitalia, it's basically study, you know, like where they treat genital sexual transmitted diseases, okay? And they, a lot of what they treat are sexual practices connected to homosexuality.
Okay.
Now, obviously, not only that, there's heterosexual people transmitting sexually transmitted diseases as well. But probability-wise, particularly amongst gay men, there is a greater risk of sexual diseases.
Yeah.
For obvious reasons.
Yeah,
do I need to spell those reasons out for you? Right. It's obvious that if you take something and you place it in a place that is a depository for waste, then there's a chance that you may get an infection.
Mm.
I'm trying to be as least graphic as possible.
Yeah.
So God is saying you don't participate in the act of homosexuality for your benefit.
Can I?
Yeah, of course, absolutely.
Okay, so I had 3 points I wanted to bring up through your talk, whatever you want to call it. You said it's God's creation, so he do what he will.
Yes, there's more to that, but yes.
Okay, so if he do what he will, just like a question, I might be being stupid here, but if he created free will,
yes.
So why would it be his will to give us the free will to do anything that we want?
That's a fantastic question. Very honest question. Let me answer you freely. So in the Christian faith, the theological principle that governs our understanding of God are these words. God is love.
Okay.
That means that God's will flows from his love. That God's will is an expression of his love. And God wants you to have a relationship with him. But I'm sure it doesn't take a genius to figure out that if that relationship is not free, there's no possibility of it being a loving relationship. Agreed?
Yeah, agreed.
So God gives you the free will with all the possibilities to screw it up and to do wrong, because that's the only way free will is meaningful, is if you can do wrong, so that you have the possibility to enter freely into a loving relationship with God. And it's in that loving relationship that your identity is created. The scriptures say, literally, you might get this as someone who identifies as non-binary, that there is neither male nor female in Christ. So what it's saying is that your identity is not in your gender.
Okay.
It's in Jesus.
Yes.
Now, if it's in Jesus and we're his disciples, then that means we have to take what Jesus said seriously. And Jesus affirms that there are two genders, male and female.
Yeah.
Biology shows that there's two or four variants of male and two or four variants of female,
yeah,
based upon the genetic makeup.
Yeah.
You know, you can get the extra X or you can get the extra Y.
Yeah.
And so there are variations of gender male and gender female, but they're still just two genders. Yeah? So that means that you don't, if you become a Christian, and I invite you to become a Christian, I want you to become a Christian, you don't need to build your identity based upon this political ideology of transgenderism, or this political ideology that's trying to refashion gender. Because these are just the opinions of men, particularly from the 1960s. Yeah? But you can have an identity in Christ which gives you value, that's not connected to your gender or your sexuality.
Okay.
And that you can be a complete human being without the need for sex. Now, I'm saying that,
yeah,
and in complete honesty, I'm not saying that that's
not
easy.
Me from Hugo.
CT?
Hustle
huh?
From Hugo.
Oh, right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, shall we continue, or do you want to stop?
Oh, no.
That's cool. Good
to see you, man.
So, what I'm saying to you is that you know, this complete identity, you know, not having sex, like, whether you're a celibate heterosexual or whether you're, you know, someone who's got homosexual feelings, it ain't easy.
Yeah.
Like, I failed,
okay,
multiple times on that story. Yeah? So I'm not pretending that it's easy. And so I'm not judging people that struggle with it. But the hard truth is, some people just don't get it lucky. Like, some people are born and they can't walk, and some people are born and they can't speak, and some people are born and they can't hear, and some people are born and they can't see, and some people are born and they're attracted to the same sex. But that doesn't mean that you have to act on it. But they're not less human beings for that reason. The imatio Deo, the image of God that gives you your dignity, is not connected to what gender you think you are or what sexuality you have in you, you know? Your dignity was given to you by God because you're made in his image, irrelevant and everything else. So you're equal to me in dignity. Now, is that not a good thing?
Yeah.
And have you heard anything that I've said so far that's bad?
No.
So I'm inviting you to follow the teacher that taught me this, Jesus Christ.
So yep. I have two more quick questions.
Okay, sure.
Alright, so the first one was, so you're saying that being a homosexual causes more diseases if you're doing it unprotected, which I completely agree with. But would there be a problem if two consenting males done it being protected with a condom? And part two of that question, I got laughed at by some Christians over there for asking it. But basic human biology dictates that the male G-spot is in the rectum.
Yeah.
So if we're made in God's image, but God doesn't want us to act upon that, why would he make the male G-spot in a place where you're not supposed to go?
Okay, two honest questions,
yeah,
two honest answers. Firstly, let's deal with the G-spot.
Mm.
It's actually debatable,
okay,
whether you can call that a G-spot.
Mm.
It's a nerve ending, and it's a nerve ending connected to the spine. It's a nerve ending, you know, the nerves have got to end somewhere.
Yeah.
The other problem with that is that it assumes that sex is about pleasure. Sex is not about pleasure, it's about reproduction. That's why the reward for having sex is ejaculation for a man. And what's the point of ejaculating? You're trying to get someone pregnant. And when a woman orgasms, her uterus contracts in such a way as to encourage sperm to move up towards the egg. So the nature points towards reproduction. It doesn't point towards pleasure as being the purpose of sex. Pleasure is the reward of trying to reproduce. Yeah, so that's the point of sex. The point of sex is to reproduce, and the reward is the pleasure.
Okay, but
that's why you do it.
Wouldn't you argue that when you're married, you can only have sex to reproduce and you can't do it for pleasure afterwards?
Well, I mean, some Christians, some ultra-conservative Christians have exactly that opinion. I'm not one of them, because I think that sex is also an expression of love.
Yeah.
Yeah? And it's a love, the love between the man and the woman. But as a Christian, I believe that all sex should have the possibility of creation.
Yeah.
Of life.
Okay.
Yeah? And again, in I've got to, those times that I've had sex outside of marriage, that I've failed in that walk, I have to confess, because I don't want to be a hypocrite, I've also used condoms. So I haven't always lived up to what it means to be a disciple of Jesus Christ. And the point about being a disciple of Jesus Christ is that you're never going to be perfect. But that doesn't mean you shouldn't try. Yeah? So being a Christian means that you're going to have to wrestle with things. You're going to have to wrestle with how do you define your identity. You may have to wrestle with who you're attracted to, when you're attracted to them, how you're attracted to them, and how you act on that. But that doesn't mean that you shouldn't do it. Now, the other point that you talked about was sex between two guys using a condom to reduce the risk. I accept today, you know, people being careful could minimize the risks quite a lot. But the reason why you shouldn't participate in these kinds of sexual desires is because they are simply not what God has designed you to do. No one with a brain would argue that the male and the female sexual organs are designed for one another.
Yeah.
Right? And no one who's fair to biology would argue that the anus is a receptacle. It's not.
Okay.
It's an exit point.
Yeah.
It's not an entry point.
100%.
Yeah, 100%. So God has created you with a nature, and that's what you should act upon. That's the direction you should go in, because that's what God wants. So when he says don't do it, again, he's doing it because you're designed to do something different. You're designed to do something different. Now, I want to stress again that, and as much as I'm preaching to myself on this one, as much as I might preach to you or to anyone else, that you're not made a more complete person because you have sex. Right? That's a battle I fight all the time. Like, I do not need to have sex to be a complete person. Right? I'm a single guy. I get all the same desires that every other man gets. So I have to struggle with this, just like I'm saying that a homosexual. Now, you might say, but it's not fair that someone has that desire towards another man. And I agree, it's not. But some people are born blind.
Yeah.
Some people are born and they can't walk.
Yeah.
Some people just get shit cards and you've got to deal with it.
Yeah.
And that's the message. Like, if you've got homosexual attraction, you just got a shit set of cards, it doesn't mean that you get to deal with it. Doesn't mean that you should act on it, you know. What it does mean is that Christians should have some compassion and some, you know, non-judgmental attitudes when they meet people from these backgrounds. No one appreciates a finger-wagging sermon. Ah, you sinner! Like, that's pastorally the worst thing you could possibly do, you know. And I think Christians should have the humility to accept there's more heterosexual sin going off in the church than there's homosexual sin going off in the church. And let's deal with that before we start wagging the finger. But as Christians, we can't celebrate pride. We can't celebrate sin. We can't endorse it. We can't say that what is wrong is right. And we can't affirm a political ideological lie that states that your identity is in your sexuality or your gender, because the Bible doesn't teach that.
Okay.
I hope you found that useful.
I did, yeah.
June, have you ever read the Bible?
I have.
Well, yes, you do, because it's part of your belief, you do.
Yeah.
So I would encourage you, look, what has this God that you believe in done for you?
Let's me be who I want.
What?
Let's me be who I want.
Okay. I put it to you that your God is not this Bathima. I put it to you that your God is yourself.
In a sense, yes.
Right. And this is where your spirituality has gone wrong. Because if you accept that there is a creator, and you accept that he created you, then that means that he has rights over you that you don't have over yourself. Like, you're not your own God. And that whole attitude of, I am my own God, it basically comes from like the 1960s onwards.
Yeah.
Definitely. Well, I mean, God has not been silent. He's talked all the way through history, bro. And if you want to... Okay.
Seconds.
All right. Have a...
Oh, yeah.
God bless.
Thank you.
God bless. Take care.
Right, let's go. Quick wrap up there.
Okay.
Right. Happy day, Bob.
So, June is a Satanist, and by Satanist, what he means is he believes in a god called Bathima, and that he believes that, and he uses the Bible, and he uses Dante's Inferno. Essentially, what June is saying is that he wants to be his own god, and that is the spirituality of the age, the god of the self. We talked about it before. It emerges out of the trauma of World War One and World War Two. It's the reason why we're having all the culture wars right now, because the god of the self and the culture of the self is trying to assert itself over everything in our society. But as Christians, we cannot agree with this god of the self or the worship of the self. We have to call people to the worship of Yahweh, your creator. If he is your creator and he made you, he has rights over you. And if he says that X is wrong, then X is wrong. He's not doing it because he's just some willful, capricious God like Allah. He's doing it because God is love, and his commandments are love, and all of his commandments are love. But so we Christians, when we meet people who buy into this political agenda of transgenderism and pride and all of that, we have to understand something. We have to drop this idea that it's a choice. Homosexuals are no more choosing to be homosexual than I'm choosing to be heterosexual. It's just not a choice. Neither is someone who's got a dysphoria about their gender. It isn't a choice. It is a diagnosable condition, and it needs to be met with compassion, understanding, and charity. And it might not be something that we can ever cure, but we've got to walk with that person as they seek genuinely to walk with Jesus. But what we can't do is try to change our image of Jesus to suit their god of self. We can't allow them to remake Jesus or God or the teachings of the prophets or the apostles to suit as a mirror what they want it to be. If you're going to be a disciple of Jesus, you've got to take Jesus seriously. And if he says that marriage is between a man and a woman, then it's between a man and a woman, and that's it. So, God bless.
Praise the Lord. God.